spooky action at a little distance. It's solved.
There we go. Seven.
Sorted.
Entangled dice.
As an avid board gamer, I roll a lot of dice. Of course, I do so to get some random number. But in actuality, is it random? Well, if you knew the weight of the dice and the force with which I was going to throw them and everything they were going to bounce off of, etc., etc., you could actually calculate the result beforehand using Newton's laws of motion. Then Einstein came along and he modified Newton's laws when he was laying down the foundations of quantum theory. Now, to do so, he had to really delve into the very fabric of the universe, and what he found disturbed him, because his mathematical predictions were that randomness seems to exist. So why did it bother him so much? That's the question that I want to bring to a friend of mine and a physicist, Chris Duffy. I'm going to see him now. Chris!
Hi, Greg.
All right. So, tell me about Einstein. Now, clever guy, named a whole hairstyle after him. I get it. So Einstein comes along and revolutionizes physics, right? You know, before it was Newtonian mechanics, and he's like, no, it was a whole new way of looking at everything. Ha ha, isn't this great? Aren't I clever? And then shortly thereafter comes quantum theory.
Yeah, I mean, he famously won the Nobel Prize not for relativity, but for his foundational work on quantum mechanics as well. So he's one of the founding fathers of quantum mechanics.
Oh, all right. I wasn't aware of that. Because what I'm thinking more about is that at some point, it kind of gets away from him, if you will, and he starts to say, wait a minute, the interpretations that are coming from this are just too weird even for me. So he starts to describe some of it as spooky.
Yeah, he famously said God does not play dice.
Okay. What does this actually mean? Einstein realized that at the quantum level, we could not determine the property of any individual subatomic particle. Some physicists suggested that this was because subatomic particles actually exist in multiple possible states at once, and that they randomly settle on one of those states of existence due to our measuring of them. Now, Einstein thought that this was just as ridiculous as it sounds. So when Einstein said, God does not play dice with the universe, it was his way of expressing his unease with quantum theory.
Well, quantum mechanics seems to imply that there is an inherent uncertainty, that quantum events occur randomly. Now, Einstein didn't like this, and there were several other features of quantum mechanics that he didn't like as well. So one of the things he did, along with another scientist called Aaron Schrodinger and people like Rosen, they did thought experiments.
Okay.
And the point of these thought experiments was to highlight the kind of seeming absurdity in quantum mechanics.
A thought experiment is one in which we know we cannot collect data, but logic can still be used to make valid points about an outcome. For example, I could ask if dinosaurs could have built spaceships. Well, we can't test this experimentally, but we can still argue about the possibilities based on what we know about them and how similar they were to other animals and whether or not animals like that can build spaceships.
One of these thought experiments is now called the Einstein-Podolsky-Rosen paradox. And it deals with this phenomenon known as quantum entanglement. That's a term I think that gets kind of bandied around quite a lot. Now, what quantum entanglement is when you have a system of particles. So, for example, let's consider two electrons.
Okay.
If you allow them to interact with each other in some way, they become entangled. And what that entangled means is it becomes impossible to describe the quantum state of one of these electrons without knowing the quantum state of the other.
Let's unpack this a bit. Physicists have figured out that subatomic particles have different types of quantum states with opposite properties, which are given terms like spin up and spin down. With entangled particles, if one is measured up, the other will be in the down state. Okay, well, I'm no God, nor am I Einstein. However, I do have dice with me.
Nice.
So I can roll these dice.
We have these two dice. Now, they're separate. Imagine they're not entangled.
Yep.
And we roll one dice, and we get a 4, and we roll the other.
The other dice can be anything.
5.
Yep.
These dice are completely uncorrelated. The roll that I get on one dice has absolutely no relationship with the roll on another dice.
Mm-hmm.
Now, in the quantum world, if we allow these kind of quantum dice to interact with each other in such a way that they become entangled, then we could have a situation where we don't know the individual outcome of a single roll of the dice, but we do know that the total outcome has to be 7, for example.
So this, now, after you've rolled a 1, this must be a 6.
And
you've kind of somehow rolled both of them by rolling just the 1. So it doesn't matter what you roll. They're both doing this. I roll this. I get a 4. This must be a 3.
It has to be a 3, yeah. So this is the idea of entanglement, basically.
And it doesn't matter how far apart these are.
No, it doesn't matter how far apart they are.
Other side of the galaxy. Universe.
Yeah. So seemingly, entangled particles, as I said, entanglement means that the state of this particle is cannot be expressed without considering the state of the other particle. That seems to be independent of the distance between those particles.
Something you need to know here is that Einstein believed that the speed of light was the ultimate speed limit for the universe. Nothing could go faster than it, not even basic information.
Apparently, this happens instantaneously.
Yeah, because there's no caveat in quantum mechanics to say, no, this takes some finite time to happen. We know that these dice are entangled. So I know that if I roll a 1, you roll a 6. And that's not like...
Right.
That
it doesn't take any time to get there.
That information doesn't take any time to get there.
And this is where Einstein has the phrase spooky action at a distance.
Yeah.
Because basically, spooky, it's totally not understandable by his or anybody's understanding of physics
exactly.
In any way. So Einstein, as far as I know, went to his grave never really believing that it was spooky, that we were someday going to find some new aspect of physics that would explain this.
So there is a way around this. Or the solution, or the seeming solution to this, is what's known as hidden variables. It's actually, there is no after-the-fact communication between our electrons. They've already kind of decided whether they're spin up and spin down. They've already decided, which one is which. And then they go off, and they're effectively not in communication with each other. But that's all right, because the decision is already being made.
Yep.
This idea that each electron exists in an indeterminate state until we measure it, that's not real. According to this idea. That's not real, actually. There are hidden variables that we're unaware of. And what we mean by hidden variables is actually our knowledge of quantum mechanics is incomplete. So there's a layer to reality that we're unaware of currently. And as soon as we become aware of that, all of this quantum weirdness goes away. We have these hidden degrees of freedom that dictate whether these electrons are spin up and spin down. And it's actually just incompleteness in our knowledge.
Hidden variables are a bit like an underground train. If you lived in medieval times, the idea that you could walk into a cave one moment and exit a completely different cave miles away would seem like some kind of weird magic. But if you were to realize that there's an underground train linking those caves, then suddenly it would all make sense. So, what are the options for how these hidden variables actually work?
Now, one of these is this idea of what they call local hidden variables.
Okay.
So this idea is that basically, as the electrons kind of, before they split up, they have a little conversation with themselves.
Okay.
There's some hidden process going on where they decide, I'm going to be this and you're going to be that.
Okay.
And then they go away and there's no further communication. The other option is this idea of non-local hidden variables. Now, so this rests on this idea of locality. So, intuitively, we think the universe is local. And what I mean by that is if an event happens at point A,
yep.
And we've got an observer at point B,
yep.
And an observer at point C,
okay.
Then in a local universe, observer B,
I'll be out here,
because he's closer,
yep.
He experiences the event at A earlier than the person at point C,
and it takes more time.
And more strongly.
Yeah.
That's a local.
Yep.
So the idea is, in a non-local universe, that is violated, that actually there can be processes that affect very distant
observers. Either C first or at the same time.
Yes, exactly.
Okay.
And so there is an idea that maybe there is a hidden level to quantum mechanics. So there are still hidden variables there, but they're non-local. That actually, they don't decide and then go away. That there is actually maybe some hidden interaction between them that is occurring non-locally. And then the other explanation is that quantum mechanics is as it's formulated. That actually neither particle knows what state it's in until one is measured, and that information is somehow communicated over vast distances.
So which is it? Local hidden variables are attractive because the idea doesn't involve any spooky action at a distance. The problem is that they contradict Einstein's original idea that the state of the particles is uncertain until they're measured. The problem with non-local hidden variables is that they require us to find something like a wormhole, which we haven't done yet. And the third option, quantum weirdness, that the universe is local, but that information can travel instantaneously, well, that violates Einstein's speed limit on the universe. It's a giant headache for Einstein and his colleagues.
The thought experiment, to show how ridiculous it is, the thought experiment leads to real experiments.
It does, yes. This thought experiment became testable eventually, I think, in the 60s and 70s. To interpret such an experiment, you need a theory, really. You need a formalism to do that. And it was a scientist called Bell provided the framework in which to understand these experiments.
John Bell realized that we could test whether or not local hidden variables were responsible. Everybody knew that if you measured one of the spins up, the other particle must be spin down. There was 0% chance that they would both be in the same direction. Bell's great insight was to see that if we rotated the frames of reference in the way that we measured these, you would get every possibility in between. And the mathematics showed that this should be a straight line if local hidden variables were at play. But if they were not, the line should be sigmoidal. And when the experiments were finally done, this was what they found. So, none of these experiments were perfect, but this strongly suggested that local hidden variables were not responsible for quantum entanglement.
And so far, no experiments we've conducted have been truly clean and truly in line kind of with what he suggested. I think the broad consensus is there are no local hidden variables. If that was the case, it would predict results that are not observed.
Okay.
It's not definitive, and there are possibly loopholes that are being exploited. We haven't kind of definitively proved this, but it certainly seems to point in that direction.
Do you have a sense of how the physics community divides up for people who really study this stuff? Is it a 50-50 split of people who are kind of on the hidden variable side?
Whether it is kind of a non-local invariable situation or a kind of quantum weirdness situation, I leave those questions for smarter people, I think, myself.
Well, I guess the only way to determine it is by an N of one, seven, spooky action at a little distance. It's solved.
There we go, seven.
Sorted.
Entangled dice.
Chris, thank you so much. It's been
my
absolutely
pleasure.
Amazing. And I gift these to you so that you can continue
fantastic.
To solve
I collect
the
dice,
problem
actually.
For us. Yeah. All right. I wanted to know why Einstein hated randomness so much. Well, now I think I found the answer, which is that randomness was just one part of quantum theory, which had several distasteful aspects, one of which was quantum entanglement, which said that objects could affect each other at a distance, any distance, instantaneously. Einstein didn't like this. Then John Bell came along and said, you know what, we can design an experiment, and some folks have done those experiments, that showed that, yes, indeed, that seems to happen and does not involve local hidden variables, which means that, indeed, there does seem to be spooky action at a distance. Physicists are always working on the next big mystery, and hopefully, by uncovering these, they'll be able to answer the question once and for all whether God really does play dice. Until next time, remember that between the question and the answer are all of the really tasty bits. So I guess the only way to really solve it is to check the entanglement.
Oh, it ain't.
No.
There you go.
Well, it's classical.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
I'm right. It's simple. I bit into a die. I couldn't eat it. All right. Ouch. That's a six-sided. I broke my tooth. Not really, but, you know, could have.